Random House Audio presents Conquistadora by Esmeralda Santiago. This is Esmeralda Santiago. Underneath the whisperings of tropic night, there is a darker whispering that death invents especially for northern men whom the tropics have come to hold. William Carlos Williams, Adam. El Encuentro, The Encounter, November 19, 1493. They came from the sea, their battered sails and black hull menacing the indigo horizon. The vessel was many times taller and longer than the people's canoes, and from them came the stench of unwashed bodies and pine tar. The men who dropped from the ship were monstrous creatures with shiny carapaces on their chests, upon their heads, and around their arms and shins. They carried spears, flags, and crosses. The people of Borinquen were afraid to reveal themselves because their villages had been ravaged so many times that they knew nothing good ever came to their shores unbidden from the sea. The mighty goddess Guabansex often unleashed huracan winds and heavy rains from the ocean to sweep away their bohíos, flood their cassava plots, and change the course of rivers. Fearsome Caribe warriors paddled their long canoes to raid their land, steal their food, kidnap their women, and slaughter their men. Although they were frightened, Borinqueños were a brave, hospitable, and hopeful people. They called to Yucaú, the mighty god of the seas, to protect them from horrors delivered from the ocean. Then they emerged from the forests. Taíno, the cacique, greeted the men from the ship with the word meaning peace, even though armored men who carried weapons seemed anything but peaceful. The sailors looked at the Borinqueños as if they'd never seen humans. They gaped at the tattooed and pierced bodies and swept their eyes over the women with an especial hunger. They stared at the cacique's feather headdress, at the golden disc he wore on his breast, at his gold bracelets, and at the small nuggets knotted with cotton thread around the warriors' necks and arms. The cacique was a shrewd leader and noticed the covetous glances. He told his Borinqueños to give the men the adornments given to them by Atabe, the goddess of sweet waters and of rivers. The cacique also gave away hammocks woven by the most gifted weavers in the village, baskets full of cassava bread, sweet potatoes, peanuts, guavas, and pineapples. The Borinqueños filled barrels with clean drinking water. With these gifts, the Borinqueños thought these men encased in metal who rattled every time they moved would climb into their enormous sailed canoe and disappear into the same horizon that had delivered them, hopefully never to return. They did leave on that November day, but waves of them came back, their vessels slicing across the horizon. Wherever they landed, they demanded tribute from the caciques and the cacicas, who offered more clear water, ever larger baskets filled with food, the best hammocks, and more nuggets. The ships would leave, and more would return. Because the first sound from the mouths of the Borinqueños was the word Taíno, the men from the sea thought the people were describing themselves and renamed them for the word peace. The men from the sea also renamed Borinquen, meaning great land of the valiant and noble lord, as San Juan Bautista, meaning St. John the Baptist. They came with weapons that severed a man's head in one stroke. They brought animals that Borinqueños had never seen, horses, pigs, hounds, goats, cattle. They trampled through the yucca fields, smoked the people's tobacco, and raped the women. The caciques and cacicas rallied the people. They charged their warriors to poison their arrows so that when the tips entered the men's unarmored flesh, their blood would flame and boil inside their bodies. When a warrior dropped his heavy club over an unhelmeted head, the macana crushed his opponent's skull as easily as if it were a calabash. They held the newcomers' faces down in the clear, fresh water of Borinquen's rivers until their bodies went limp. The women fed them unprocessed cassava to churn their guts into mush. The men from the sea were too strong, their weapons lethal. They brought enormous dogs to chase and herd the people from their villages, and after men in heavy robes sprinkled the borinqueños with water and made perplexing gestures over them, they changed the borinqueño ancestral and clan names to their own language. They forced the women to cover their breasts, their bellies, the hallowed parts from which their children reached into the sun. They called themselves católicos. They called themselves españoles. Their chiefs called themselves caciques, even though none were born in Borinquen from borinqueñas. Their most famous chieftain was Juan Ponce de León, who lined up the borinqueños and pointed at this one, at that one, at the other. He separated men from women, mothers from children, elders from their families. He formed them into groups. Then his men led the borinqueños from their villages to other parts of the island. They enslaved the borinqueños to labor in waist-deep water in the island's rivers and forced them to rip from Atabey's pebbled, sandy veins the shiny nuggets she'd so willingly gifted before the men came from the sea. The borinqueños began to die from diseases they'd never known and from infected wounds opened on their backs and arms and legs from whips they'd never experienced. They died in rebellions, their numbers easily overwhelmed by men on horses carrying sharp swords. They died from exhaustion in the mines, processing the shiny nuggets into blocks. They died from terror. They threw themselves into the chasms above the highest peaks of the mountains. They drowned in the sea. Sharks attacked them when rafts broke up as they paddled, searching for another island where they could rebuild their vegetable plots and their communities. They fled into the mountains, where they were chased and captured by hounds. They died of humiliation after hot irons branded their foreheads. They died in such numbers that their language began to die, too, and the names of their ancestors and most of their gods were silenced from tongues. The Borinqueño culture, traditions, and history were chronicled by the conquerors who called them savages, who misinterpreted their customs and rituals, who told them that if they didn't renounce their own gods, they would live in flames in the next life. Borinqueñas were made to lie with the newcomers because the men from the sea didn't bring their own women, and another race grew from their children. The last full-blooded Borinqueño saw another kind of people walking upon Borinquen's ground. Men, women, and children kidnapped, chained, and transported on groaning ships across the ocean from lands beyond the dawn. Like the Borinqueños, they knew the ways of the forest, but they were darker-skinned and spoke different languages. They, too, were branded, dragged, pushed, and whipped to work in the rivers. And when the goddess Atabey refused to give up more gold, the black men were made to cut down trees to build dwellings made from wood and from stone for their masters. The sacred yucca fields were razed so that other crops more amenable to the conquerors could grow, because even though there was no more gold in Borinquen, men and even women kept coming from the sea. Part 1. Conquistadores. 1826 to 1849. De músico, poeta y loco, todos tenemos un poco. We're all a bit of a poet, a bit of a musician, a bit mad. Conquistadores. Ana was a descendant of one of the first men to sail with the Grand Admiral of the Ocean Sea himself, Don Cristóbal Colón. Three men on her father's side were among the first conquistadores, Basque sailors with intimate knowledge of the sea and fearless curiosity about what lay beyond the sunset. Two of her Larragoity ancestors died at the hands of fierce Caribes on Hispaniola. The third, Agustin, distinguished himself as a bold civilizer and Christianizer, and in 1509 was rewarded with an entire village of natives on the island of San Juan Bautista. The Taínos collected enough gold to allow Agustin to return to Spain, where, for reasons the family never learned, he chose to retire in Sevilla rather than in his ancestral village. He also changed the spelling of his surname, dropping the final I and substituting it with a Y, a letter that didn't exist in the Basque language. Ana surmised that, for Agustín, the homely I at the end of Larragoity was not quite as grand as the looped, curlicued Y that bespoke affluence and masculine aggression. Subsequent generations of Larragoity sons and nephews sailed down the Rio Guadalquivir from Sevilla, hoping to repeat Agustin's success. According to Ana's father, Gustavo, there were Larragoity descendants in Mexico, Peru, and Venezuela, all said to be rich beyond imagining. On the Cubillas side, her mother, Jesusa, boasted three soldiers, two Franciscan friars, and three merchants whose journals and letters describing the rigors and rewards of settling in the West Indies were passed down the generations, read and discussed at solemn gatherings. Cubillas' descendants, too, were scattered all over the New World, their fortunes secure and said to be among the leading families of the Antilles. The feats over man and nature that brought such pride, however, were speculation. Neither the Larragoity nor Cubillas families in Spain knew for certain what happened to the conquistadores, merchants, and religiosos after 1757, when letters from the last correspondent in the colonies, a tobacco grower in Cuba, stopped. Their written exploits, by then mythologized and exaggerated so that they bore little resemblance to the first-hand accounts, were kept in safe boxes in the homes of the current patriarchs of the Larragoity and Cubillas clans. Their wealth, pride, and honor depended on male heirs, but Gustavo and Jesusa buried three consecutive sons within weeks of their birth. In the seventh year of their marriage, and after a day and a half of labor, Jesusa delivered a healthy girl on July 26, 1826, who looked nothing like her living relatives, all of whom were tall, sturdy, light-haired, light-eyed, long-nosed men and women whose supercilious lips curled in disdain at the smallest provocation. If Jesusa hadn't suffered for 29 hours to deliver her into the world, she wouldn't have claimed the small-boned, black-haired, black-eyed girl who looked like no one but the portrait of Don Agustin dominating the gallery. Jesusa named her Gloriosa Ana María de los Ángeles Larragoity Cubillas Nieves de Donostia, called Ana, in praise of the saint protectress of pregnant women, on whose day Ana was born. A sturdy gypsy was hired to nurse her, since it was unbefitting for elite women to offer their own breasts to their children. Ana thrived and survived beyond a few days, then 3 months, then six, then nine, and by her first year was wobbling and lurching from her nurse's arms to those of her maid. Jesusa doubled her prayers and charity work, hoping that Santa Ana would intercede on her behalf so that she'd conceive again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.